Akafinya damu kwa kikombe kabisa ikajaa.
Just that I'm clear, I don't do that.
Ai kuchukua dakika 10. Watu wa media walijaa hapa.
So akachukua kisu na akanidunga sasa hapa. So I could feel nguvu yenye kwa ndani yake.
Mimi nilisikia mambo hiyo nikashtuka. Sababu ukimwona uwezi sema ni mtu kwa maana anafanya tabia kama hiyo.
Not the blood of a human being, nothing else. But so to me, I cannot connect. I've never done it.
I remember one asked me, bado mnakunywa damu?
So nikatoa sema sina damu, nikapelekea pastor.
You may say it was strange than fiction, but it happened to someone. Two young women are kidnapped, tortured and raped for days by a man in Naivasha. The two are later rescued by the police, but not before they are subjected to what they later tell the police was satanic rituals. Tonight on Case Files, The Cannibal. In 2008, Naivasha town is dusting itself from a month of post-election violence that has claimed more than 1,000 lives across the country. 8 months after attaining some semblance of peace and stability, the town erupts again. This time it's not about machete welding gangs flashing out unsuspecting motorists from passenger service vehicles on the highway and butchering them. It's about a single individual who has struck fear at the heart of a troubled town. Angry residents have taken it upon themselves to stop in his tracks, what they suspect is a serial killer and rapist on the loose. In tow are Red Cross officials and police officers. In the laid-back and low-income Kyoto estate is a shocking discovery. Earth movers bring down a madhouse, and beneath, an area where there was once a bed, is a badly decomposed body of a woman. Police arrest a person commonly referred to as Fongo, as Red Cross officials take away the woman's body. Naivasha has a cannibal in town. The arrest was by chance, the police tell the media. A 16-year-old girl who managed to run away from the house alerted the police. The girl told the police she had been held captive in the house for a week by Geoffrey Maderi, alias Fongo.
Alafu kuna siku alinidunga, akafinya damu kwa kikombe kabisa ikajaa. Hapo ikikataa kutoka anadunga pengine anafinya sana mpaka itoke.
The young lady tells the police she was not alone in the dingy and dusty house. Esther Akinyi says Naomi Wanjiru had been left behind. Akinyi tells the police Naomi is unable to escape. She is weak and on the verge of death.
Anyone would feed off another man is a phenomenon that even residents of Kihoto have been unable to comprehend.
Maderi becomes an instant news item. Maderi drops names of people he claims sent him to abduct, kill and ferry their private parts to them. Human blood was part of the assignment. Bishop Jeremiah Palangio's name is one of those mentioned by a man who confessed to the police that he has killed, feasted and drank human flesh and blood. The bishop is called in by the police for questioning, and eager media is in tow.
The street kids are like these street boys. I feel them, they know me. And when they arrest one of them say, this is the man who sent me the blood. And once in my heart is that I'm clear, I don't do that.
At the time, Geoffrey Maderi alias Fongo told the police he had delivered several liters of blood to the man of the cloth charge. The new hope for nation's charge. The preacher is booked into a police station as investigations into what police had first suspected was a simple case of kidnapping turns into a complex probe of rape, murder, and cannibalism. After 14 days, Geoffrey Matheri alias Fongo is arraigned before a Naivasha court to face charges of kidnapping and rape. Matheri was accused of raping and illegally confining two women in his house. Matheri faces the further charge, that of illegal confinement. The prosecution called in several witnesses, among them Naomi Wanjiru, a kidnapped victim. Wanjiru told the trial magistrate it was Fongo who assaulted them and drank their blood. Wanjiru told the court she witnessed Geoffrey Matheri bite her friend before turning on her and drawing blood from her hands and body. The court was told it was Fongo raped, feasted and drank the blood of his victims for several days. In fact, the prosecution claimed Fongo had a corpse in the house by the time he abducted the 14-year-old woman and Naomi Wanjiru, a mother of two. The prosecution painted Fongo as a cannibal, a man who was out to inflict massive pain on his victims before dismembering their bodies, a man who killed without a care in the world, a man who killed to gain at all costs. A police officer testified how they came to the rescue of two women who had been assaulted and raped in the hands of Fongo. Bloodstained clothes and other items in the house painted a picture of a murderer, a cannibal, and a sadist. But after 4 years on trial, Naivasha court acquitted Geoffrey Matheri of 4 counts of rape and assault. The prosecution, the magistrate ruled, had only proved the illegal confinement charge against Fongo. Fongo told the court he was a remorseful man and a first-time offender. Fongo wanted the court to pardon him. The magistrate was, however, not pleased with the prosecution's evidence on the assault and rape charges. An important exhibit, a P3 form that should have supported rape and assault claims against the accused, was not produced in court. Matheri was a free man on the serious charges of rape and assault. He was only found guilty of the less offense of illegal confinement. Fongo was jailed for 4 years, but in Nakuru was still a wanted man. He was wanted for the murder of the only victim police linked him to. He was driven back to prison. Case files, caught up with the man at the center of cannibalism claims. Adorned in prison attire, Matheri still strikes one with his piercing eyes and a limping walking style. Nothing much has changed about him. Matheri told case files he was a man on a mission. He was a man under instructions. He was a man under oath.
Jua ni kama venye tu hivyo tumekutana na yeye. Wasema yeye huyo mtu alikuwa ananijua bereni. Lakini yeye hakukuwa amenipa ile kibarua. Hasa mimi kibarua yenye alikuja alitupata tukua pale na tunakunywa ngamu. Tukua survivor. Akuja atuambia nani anaweza jua maisha yake iendelee mzuri. Atoke pale hapa, akuwa akuwa na nini na nyumba yake na aoe. Achae na hii mambo ya street. Sidio mimi nikakubali. Sasa ndio sasa tulienda na yeye. Kaniambia tukakaa na yeye karibu mwezi mmoja. Hata hii ndio kibarua alikuja akaniambia hii kibarua ndio naweza ukupe.
Fongo had to undergo a medical examination before he will be allowed to stand trial for the murder of his many victims. Fongo says he killed more men than women. What drove him?
Alafu kuna siku alinidunga akafinya damu kwa kikombe kabisa ikajaa. Apo ikikata kutoka anadunga pengine anafinya sana mpaka itoke.
Huyo mtu alikuwa ananijua bereni. Lakini yeye hakukuwa amenipa ile kibarua. Hasa mimi kibarua yenye alikuja alitupata tukua pale na tunakunywa ngamu. Tukua survivor.
The street kids are like these street boys, I feel them, they know me. And when they arrest one of them say, This is the man who sent me the blood.
Tukakaa na yeye karibu mwezi mmoja, hata hii kidogo kibadua alikuja akaniambia hii kibadua ndio naweza kukupa hii ya kuua.
Naivasha town has had its own share of intriguing and shocking at times, bizarre incidents. It was in Naivasha where Philip Onyanche, self-confessed serial killer, told the media he started his killing spree from. Onyanche will say the only thing he did was to greet his victims. The rest was a story of a bizarre ritual of strangling and sucking of blood out of his victims.
When she passed the first time, I saw her. And the urge came. So the second time she came back, I called her and then I greeted her. From there it was just slam dunk.
That was 3 years after a new serial killer showed up in Naivasha. Geoffrey Madheri, alias Fongo, was that new killer. Fongo claims he had such powers.
Where bado unanifuata? Sasa hiyo ndio nilikuwa naua watu.
I came to Naivasha 1989 to begin to live in Naivasha. I had come to Naivasha the first as a junior mission work back in 1986 June. I did a crusade which was a church planting, and so I went back. In 1989, I was transferred to Naivasha. And the same year, December of that year, I married. I did my wedding.
The bishop says it was smooth sailing. His church, New Hope for All Nations at the center of Naivasha town, had held a successful conference that brought on board various church ministries from across the country.
I received a call. I was driving that day, so the phone was from one of the DCIO Naivasha, asking me, Bishop, where are you? I say, I'm on my way from Nairobi. Okay, I ask him, what is this, something I can help you quickly because I'm driving? Then he say, no, it's not a serious issue, but I just wanted to see you. Then I say, okay, if I arrive in Naivasha enough time, I'll pass through your office.
Bishop Jeremiah Petro Palanjo was a man at the center of serious allegations. Jeremiah was arrested.
But that my congregation was about approaching 800 members. Yes, 800.
That Sunday morning,
yeah.
How many people?
At least we had about 150 just coming in at the police station. So then after that one, on a Monday, very early in the morning, I was called out of the cell. So I was told, Bishop, get ready, we are going to Gilgis. So I found the doctor who was doing that was my then member in one of the church in Gilgis. So he was shocked, say, Bishop, you have been brought here for me to test your mental something. I said, oh yes, yeah, you need to do your job, man. Just make sure that you check everything. You want to check my saliva, my whatever, just make sure you give the right report. Then from there he did it, and after that one, the officers, they say, we need to go to lunch. They put us in the police cell in Gilgil, me and the boy. They went for another 2 hours. So they came back, brought us back to Naivasha around 4 in the evening.
Police wanted to have him charged for the murder of a woman found in the house of Geoffrey Madheri. Rape charges were also awaiting him. As the bishop was being driven away, angry crowds were moving to his church. They wanted to bring it down. Charles Mulungu told Case Files the news of the church being set ablaze by angry residents caught church members and his leadership by surprise.
We had a very successful conference, a two-week conference, and when it ended on that material day, I believe I was at home. I had taken a leave for the conference, so I was relaxing. After every two-week conference, we do relax. It's a lot of job, and then is when I was called by one of the pastors and told me that there is a huge congregation in our church. Some are shouting, fire, fire. And then we had to drop, only to come and find that mess. And at that time is when Bishop had been arrested.
The arrest of the bishop came as a shocker.
It was unbelievable at the first time, because being connected to the bishop, and then there is word coming that there could be some other things. Of course, we knew these things do happen. They do happen outside. It was shocking and unbelievable to us, because I believe in the conference, because men of God do come to the conference from various ministries around the nation, at least one of them should have sensed if there was anything bad, should have sensed. So we were in that state. This is unbelievable. And at the moment, you could not make a conclusion. We needed to know how the bishop was, where he was, and what was happening.
Bishop says he had seen Madheri just like he had other state children in Naivasha town, but he had not interacted with him. Riding in a police Land Rover was the first time he came across a man who had confessed to killing mostly women.
I'm sitting here, he's sitting there. He looked from here to Gilgil. He never looked at me. He just looked aside until we arrived in Gili, like shaking your hand. Your name is Lawrence, blah, blah, what do you do, and so forth. Because he's not even a member of the church. In our record, we don't have a member. Maybe he used to be a member one time, and then he was kicked out of the church because of behavior. Nowhere, no record, actually. Even my people, when it came to the media, and my people in the church were asking, do you know this boy? Do you know this boy?
Geoffrey Madheri, alias Fongo, had sensationally singled him out as the recipient of human blood from victims that he had killed. The bishop says it was more than just a sensational claim.
I've seen so many people, people possessed with demons. This boy is not himself. There's something working behind the curtain. And therefore, I could not talk to him, because he was not the one. He himself was used. And unfortunately, he allowed the forces to use him. He became the instrument. But
news that Bishop Jeremiah had been released from custody reached them halfway through the service.
Bishop was set free. His church erupted into song and praise. Police investigators in Naivasha had no evidence linking him to a mysterious body in the house of Geoffrey Madheri, alias Fongo, now christened the Naivasha Vampire.
Decision by the police to set Bishop Aranjo free after failing to obtain any evidence linking him or the church he leads to the criminal activities is a confirmation of what we knew all along, that the bishop was innocent.
I have forgiven my accuser. I have no grudge against him. And my prayer is that God may forgive him and save his soul.
The only reason they gave me that, after I read the letter, they say, you cannot sleep here. We have been instructed to release you. And you cannot sleep here. The same story I was told the day they were pushing me in. It's the same story we're saying, that somebody will lose the job if you don't arrest you.
The police failed to link him to gory details of cannibalism emerging from Madheri. Police had failed to connect him or his church to the bizarre pronouncement that are now gained traction in Naivasha and its adjacent towns. Almost 7 years later, the man Geoffrey Madheri dragged into his allegations of blood-sucking and human flesh-feasting says he has never had anything to do with human blood and flesh.
I was very much wounded. I was bleeding. It's only that if my heart was removing blood, you will see the drop of blood out of my heart. And very much. And my children mostly.
He was and is still a man of the cloth, a servant of God and the people. Kilometers away at Naivasha Maximum Security Prison, Geoffrey Madheri told case files he was enlisted to deliver to churches human body parts and blood.
Sasa mimi sikuwa najijua ni ile nguvu nilikuwa nayo. Sasa ni venye tu naweza ua kitu kidogo, useme hiyo kitu ni kidogo sana. Mimi naachana. Naua, nabeba, naona hiyo ni kitu kidogo kwangu sana. kumtibua mwanamke. Anatoa matiti peke yake ama ana damu, matiti na damu.
Na ndio unaweka wapi kisha? Container utakuta.
Kuna sufuria, sufuria hii ya kupikia. Kuna ingine ilikuwa nimenunua hiyo kazi. Hata saa ingine kama situmii hiyo nguvu, nachukua kisu nachinja. Damu namwagika kwa sufuria. Ingine yenye namwagika huko na kata hiyo inatoka, hiyo naikunywa, hiyo ni yangu ya kunywa. Lakini kwa zile hii ya singa yenye inatoka, hiyo ni yangu. Hiyo ni ya kazi. Lakini yangu yenye nilikuwa nakunywa kwa patakwata hivi. Lakini sana sana ni kuo si kuwa nakunywa hivyo kama kukura. Kukura ndio nilikuwa nakulaga watu sana.
Why will Geoffrey Madheri Pikone Manu says he had a small church and a small congregation at the time?
I think my answer will be simple, that that's a question also I need somebody to help me one of these days to know why did he did that one. Because even today I don't have an answer why he did that one.
The Attorney General will later write to the Bishop clearing him of any wrongdoing. The Bishop says he has since moved on.
When people discover that maybe his daughter, he fellowship in this church, they could influence, even threaten to cast them. I used to go into that church of blood drinker. They used to use those words. And we end up to lose our members. 800 members, they came down to almost 220. Because others were forcing to get out of the church and so forth. In fact, some people used to stand in the gate on a Sunday to see who is walking. My members were humiliated by people. Those who were fat a little bit, they could hear people say, unaona vile ule kamenona, ule amekunywa damu ya bishop wao amewapatia damu mpaka amenona sana. So it was very much hurting. So I wish that actually there is a way that that things will never repeat again. And my members have healed, I've healed myself, my family they have healed.
The new hope for Nations Church still stands. The numbers have soared again since what the bishop says was an unfortunate event 7 years ago. His followers told case files for almost 2 years it was their word against a suspicious public. It was the most trying moment for the church congregation.
With this kind of thing, it affected very much. It hits. It hits even families. And it's a case where it can hit even your own family. So some members really went. Some members had to go. Of course, if I come to you with this kind of message, just very quickly, and it becomes a shock to you, you make a decision very quickly, you leave the ministry and say I cannot be associated with this kind of mess.
Tata hiyo kitu ijaisha hata sai. Ijaisha bado. Ijaisha bado. Nakumbuka kuna mahali nipata kazi kwa shule. Wakasikia na kujaga hii church. In fact, mwalimu akaniambia, "Ha, na si utakula watoto wetu."
When I came out and we had a Thanksgiving day, My children, they were going back to school. I remember my daughter was doing the last exams that time, and they request one thing. They said, "Daddy, we have forgiven whoever who did these things, but we are requesting one thing, that when we come back, let's not go to live in the same estate where we used to live. We have our own small land somewhere. We can also become an IDP. Please take us." They didn't want to mix with the people. They felt wounded.
It has not been a welcoming place either for Geoffrey Madheri, the man who sensationally dropped the names of the bishop and other people as the recipients of his services, is still in custody. Madheri is still facing a murder trial. Next week on Case Files, we take you back to Naivasha, where we speak for the first time to a victim of Madheri, a young lady who watched the self-confessed killer bite off the body of her fellow victim before drinking her own blood. Case Files, The Cannibal, continues next week. Denis Onsarigo for Case Files.